So I'll be talking about turbulence in the Bay of Bengal. I belong to the Fluid Dynamics and Turbulence Group. I'm Ritabrata, a graduate student with Professor Ramagovindarajan here. And this work has been done in collaboration with Professors Emily Schroer, Thomas Farrar, Robert Weller, and James Norman Moom. And I'd like to thank the funding agencies and, of course, my institutions, TFI Hyderabad and ICTS Bangalore. And really, big thanks to the organizers for this initiative in-house 2019. I hope this goes on for many years to come. So before delving into the Bay of Bengal, just a brief overview of why we do care about oceans. This water, by virtue of having a high heat capacity, carries a lot of heat. And 70% of Earth's surface is covered by ocean, and 97% of all the water available on Earth is found in oceans. So the oceans, it's big, and it has a very high heat capacity. And hence, it has very strong capabilities of influencing regional and global climate. Sorry, weather. And a recent press release by the India Meteorological Department just 7 days ago says that, good thing, the monsoon will be normal this year. So probably good agriculture and economy for the years for the next year. But something I'd like to point out is that it says the sea surface temperature conditions over the Pacific and the Indian Ocean are known to have strong influence of the Indian monsoon. If you read this statement carefully, there is a pertinent question. Pacific and Indian monsoon seems like they are thousands of kilometers apart. And this becomes sometimes probably it doesn't ring a bell. Something happening over the Pacific can affect a local phenomena like the Indian monsoon. But as Ganga Prasad had already mentioned, these there's something called teleconnection. And these atmosphere and oceans evolve not separately, but by being very strongly coupled to each other. And sometimes something on the other side of the globe can affect a very small regional system, Indian monsoon. By small, I mean as compared to the global landscapes. So the next question arises, if the Pacific and the Indian Ocean is important, could the Bay of Bengal, which is a very near ocean to us, sorry, sea or a bay near to us, could be important? So this is a schematic, and people refer to this schematic very often. And the color you see is the salinity, or the amount of salt, the concentration of salt in water. And as you can see, Bay of Bengal, the waters in the Bay of Bengal, they communicate with the atmosphere via various routes, like evaporation, like momentum transfer by raining clouds, and by driving convection due to the boundary layer pressure gradients. So the answer to this is most probably because people have evidence, and with the overmature collection of literature, it says that Bay of Bengal probably has a very strong influence on the monsoon system as well as the active and break periods of the Indian monsoon. So Ganga Prasad referred to this. I'm showing you the slide, and this shows you for 1950 to 1980 the areas of generation of monsoon depressions and cyclones. And these show that most of, like all of these monsoon depressions initiate over the Bay of Bengal. And one striking feature is that it initiates above this 20 degree north latitude, which separates the northern bay and the southern bay. So then the motivation is, if it's so important, let's do a study on this. And this is the experimental location which was chosen, and the experiment was carried out for over a year. You can't sit in the ocean for 1 year, so you put something like this, a floating buoy, a 2 meter diameter float, and it has chain below it, which is about 2.5 kilometers long, and it has various instruments. various instruments which measure various things like temperature, salinity, speed, turbulence. And these are the instruments after being recovered from this mooring line of this buoy. You go on a ship, deploy it, go back 1 year later, take it back. And these are the instruments. Then you analyze the data. So turbulence measuring instruments were developed in the laboratories of Oregon State University. These are basically a combination of thermistors and pitot tube. They measure speed and temperature fluctuations. And they were put at various depths, starting from 20 meters to 65 meters. One was lost, so just to make you aware of the reality of the situations, someone probably got lost in a fishing line or someone probably stole it. These measure the temperature fluctuations, and by assuming Taylor frozen flow hypothesis, you go from temperature fluctuations to spatial fluctuations in temperature, and by doing a balance of the temperature-energy equation, temperature fluctuation-energy equation, you get to a component called chi, which is the sink in the energy equation, and by assuming something like an eddy viscosity, eddy diffusivity model, you come to this man-made quantity called turbulent diffusivity, which is just the chi here. I like to point out that this is molecular diffusivity and this is turbulent diffusivity. This doesn't make any physical sense. It's not a property of the fluid, but it's a property of the flow. And this gradient is the vertical temperature gradient. From now on, when I refer to temperature turbulence, I refer to turbulent diffusivity or vice versa. So next three slides will give you a brief overview of the three key results from our 1 year long deployment. Again, to remind you, this is the location of our study. And when you look at it carefully, the color is salinity. When you look at it carefully, one very striking feature is that this is very blue as compared to things below. So, and when you observe the date, it's 7th of August. It's the later half of the summer monsoon. It had rained over the Indian landmass. And many big rivers bring this, like Ganga, Brahmaputra, Meghna. They bring this very 1,000-kilometer-long shallow lens of fresh water to this experimental location. And we see it has some impact on the results that we see and when you compare it from something elsewhere in the world. So the first key result is that the turbulence in the Bay of Bengal has a seasonality. It's mostly the case for the upper sensor. So this is the 20-meter sensor. But while going down, we see that the turbulence in the second half of the summer monsoon had gone down more than an order of magnitude. And this shift is, and this gives us a very good trend in the shift as we go deeper downwards. The median values of the first half of the summer monsoon and the second half of the summer monsoon keeps on shifting. The second key result is that the turbulence in the Bay of Bengal has a periodicity. When the wind force turbulence comes down to a very low level, we see a very strong 1 month long diurnal signal in turbulence, which according to at least my knowledge, people haven't observed in the oceans for such a strong and persistent diurnal signal. And by preliminary elimination methods, we have come to a very crude conclusion that it might be biogenically forced, like fish or zooplanktons moving up and down can create ocean mixing. And many people across different countries have followed up. They were following up on biogenically forced turbulence. We probably feel this is one of the first observations from a real ocean. The third key point is that the near surface salinity, if you remember the map that I showed you, this very strong lens of fresh water had arrived on the experimental location in the second half of the monsoon. And that shuts down turbulence below 40 meters. So this is an average of 40 to 60 meters turbulence level, and it suppresses turbulence by more than an order of magnitude once this near surface stratification has come up. And one very striking feature is that this is a cyclone, this very strong bar that you see, and wind speeds were over 90 kilometers per hour, and this could not generate mixing even below 55 meters. So the 60 meters, the color bar, blue shows that it's very quiet, but when you compare it to the pre-freshwater arrival period, like before the freshwater, the low salinity lens had arrived in the mooring location, this relatively weaker wind stress could generate mixing till about 60, 65 meters. So we referred to some literature 4 decades ago, and seems like it was a problem of the theoretical and experimental interest to many groups here in Bangalore also. And we wanted to follow it up. The first step, obviously, was to do a linear stability of the governing equations. In this case, it's the Navier-Stokes equation. Where rotation is neglected, and there's a buoyancy term, which is nothing but a reduced gravity. It's a forcing term to the momentum equations. And there is an evolution equation for the buoyancy itself by this diffusivity. And then you And I'll remind you again that we have velocity, temperature, salinity. So buoyancy is calculated from temperature and salinity. And then you perturb these profiles and look for normal mode disturbances. And then you can formulate something called a viscous form of the Taylor-Goldstein problem. And it's an eigenvalue problem. It has stratification built in into it. And this viscous term that you see could be a molecular or turbulent in origin. And with appropriate boundary conditions, we apply it to the Bay of Bengal. So I distinguish, I show you the temperature and salinity. These are the two vitals to distinguish between the pre and post monsoon, pre and post freshwater arrival periods. The red one shows you what happens after the freshwater had arrived. The near surface salinity becomes very less, and hence there is a strong stratification in salinity. So if you just remember this figure, we'll move on. When we apply this tool, this linear stability tool, we see that the buoyancy, the velocity eigenfunctions below 40 meters of depth loses energy after the arrival of this low salinity water. Also, the buoyancy eigenfunctions lose energy after the arrival of this low salinity water, and hence low salinity water, which had induced a very strong near surface stratification. So this is a preliminary conclusion. One of the other, so by being inspired, the phenomena of relaminarization, we started looking at turbulence as a dynamical systems, in a dynamical systems point of view, where turbulence follows a, sorry, a turbulence is a certain fixed point in the dynamical space, and it can go take various routes to go to turbulence or come back from turbulence to laminar states. And this is an ongoing work, and our contribution is to derive the viscosity stratification perturbation equations. And there is a nonlinear, so the tool we are applying is a nonlinear stability tool, where you do a looping by the direct and the adjoint equations, and you get to the optimal solutions. And we want to apply it to the oceanic conditions most appropriately to the Bay of Bengal. So these are the conclusions. We have shown that turbulence in the northern Bay of Bengal has a seasonality. Mostly the upper 30 meters shows a seasonality, which varies by the winds. And this is a response both to stratification and wind forcing. Turbulence shut down below 40 meters because of buoyancy suppression. And linear stability captures some of the qualitative feature of this relaminarization. And we have an ongoing problem on like nonlinear stability. It's the most general stability problem that you can apply. And so the first three conclusions are from a reference show in a letters from a group. And thank you.
Rudra, for the nice talk. And it's time for comments and questions.
I didn't understand your definition of turbulence. I mean, is it just the amount of fluctuations around the mean? Is that roughly what it is?
By turbulence, I mean turbulent diffusivity, the quantity that I calculated, the chi upon the gradient of...
What exactly does... I mean, I can't see the motivation for the definition that you used.
Oh, okay, so when you look at the energy equation, the vertical fluctuations, in, like W prime, T prime, terms is approximated as a KT times gradient. Having the in-phase fluctuations of vertical velocity as well as temperature, that's what means the W prime, T prime in the energy equation. So that is, so this is an eddy viscosity approach. You just make up a quantity called KT, which represents how this W prime, T prime is how it is dissipated. That term is dissipated. So that when you do this energy balance, then this KT is approximated as chi over TZ.
What information it gives, this quantity?
So it's like whatever quantity gives for a fluid. I mean, honey is a high viscous fluid. I mean, very small scale motions would be quickly dying out in honey than in probably water. And so this quantity is molecular. It's a quantity, it's a quality which you apply it to a fluid. But this is a quantity which you apply it to a flow. So these are analogous, just that this is a made-up quantity, which shows you how strong the turbulence is, how strong the fluctuations are, how strong it. Yeah, so when this approaches molecular level, so molecular level is around somewhere here. So these are some of the molecular levels. These are 1 minute averages. When this quantity reaches molecular level, so it's not turbulent. So it cannot go beyond -6. I mean, because it's water and it's limited by this -6 value. So -6 is the molecular viscosity of water. But when it's turbulent, this made up quantity is called KT.
Are there more questions? Yeah.
So you said something about the bioforce things. Do you also see seasonalities in that, or can you measure that basically?
This is the first measurement of turbulence in the northern Bay of Bengal. At least from turbulence, this is the first time we have seen. I'm sure you might be aware of the papers by John Dabiri's group. And so they have shown that when there's a high number density, these moving organisms can mix up ocean. I mean, they come from 600 meters to top to get food and nutrients and then go back again. And in absence of wind stress or any other forcing agents, these might be causing the mixing. So what we are looking at is only the acoustic backscatter layer, from which layer the velocity comes back. Mm. So I'm using jargon, it's not proper, but I mean, there is no other way I can explain. But looking at the acoustic backscatter, we can preliminarily conclude that there is something moving up and down. And it's not seen in the wind stress, nor in the solar forcing, nor in temperature, nor in salinity, then it has to be something that's biogenically forced, probably.
My question was, do you see seasonalities in that?
No, I mean, this is the first.
You don't, so you don't have.
Yeah. Yeah, so that is what. There is no ancillary data to support this turbulence. There is nothing. There is no wind stress, periodicity in wind stress, neither other data which supports that this could happen. So if nothing else happens, then it might be biogenically forced. And So we have looked at the tidal energy. Both the semi-diurnal and diurnal tidal energy are less. So that's a very good point, actually. So we are checking out the tidal energy at this location. It weren't that prominent. And also, it doesn't last for one month. I mean, if it was tidal, it lasts for a few days and it dies away. And also, the thing is, this signal is probably seen somewhere else also, but these are not as persistent as this month in July.
For more questions, so let's thank Ritabrata once again.